Meta Leadership, How to See What Others Don't and Make Great Decisions. Written and narrated by Constance Dierickx, PhD, with additional bonus content provided by Mark Levy. Introduction. Friday, June 17th, began as a sunny, if slightly windy, day along the Scottish coast of the North Sea. Visitors leaned into the wind, fearing they might be blown sideways or worse. In contrast, residents carried on as if it were an ordinary day, utterly unworthy of comment. Stone houses on narrow streets had open windows with curtains batting like pale eyelashes, while overhead, seabirds, barely flapping their wings, moved with the wind currents. Returning to their cruise ship, visitors told stories of ancient churches, the kindness of the locals, and their surprise at the strong wind and cold temperature. Alfred Korzybski, a scientist and philosopher, said, "A map is not the territory," and this experience was, for me, a perfect embodiment of the idea. I had read about the places we would visit, and Scottish-born and raised friends warned me about the cold, rain, and wind. I had gone so far as to purchase a new barber coat, complete with hood. The coat, as terrific as it was, could not shield me from the weather. On the bridge, the ship's captain was surveying the territory with entirely different methods: navigation tools and weather reports. Passengers, including me, were preoccupied by what we could see, but the captain was busy predicting. He knew a storm was headed toward the north of Scotland, the Orkney and Shetland Islands, exactly where the ship was headed, and precisely where my husband and I had been planning to visit. I was focused on my own experience, on the present and recent past, but the captain was concerned with a larger and more intricate landscape, which would soon become obvious. At 4:30 p.m., during the daily tea time, the captain made an announcement. We would be going to neither the Orkney Islands nor the Shetlands. Instead, we would spend the next 2 days hanging out in the North Sea, well south of the weather that could imperil us. As soon as the announcement was over, passengers began expressing their opinions about what was happening. They ran the full gamut from angry to grateful. I felt disappointment, then immediately short-circuited that feeling with the same thought I have when a flight I'm on is diverted or changes trajectory unexpectedly at an angle not usual for commercial travel. My thought is always that the person making the decision is the best person to make it. Why? Because the person deciding has an array of educational and training experiences and has performed in situations in which the criteria for what is good enough is clear. A great pilot is a leader who must think holistically and intentionally if they are to avoid the invisible traps that can trip up even smart and experienced people. The ship's captain on June 17th had to consider the weather and what the ship could safely navigate, but also how passengers might react to being aboard in high winds and waves that would cause the ship to feel unstable. The captain delivered a calm, clear, and organized message, referring to his most important duty, ensuring the safety of the ship and its passengers. Next, he described the conditions to the north and how they were expected to evolve. Finally, he informed us of the risk of attempting to sail into these conditions and stated his decision and the plan. I listened with the concern of a passenger and the experience of a consultant who has worked with hundreds of leaders. I felt confident in this captain and admired his skill as a leader. It is people like him, and there are many, who can think above and beyond, direct their emotion in the most helpful way, and act with confidence that is credible, who exemplify meta leadership. Meta leadership is essential. Leaders today face greater challenges than at any other time in history. They must make decisions in a complex environment that changes with lightning speed and in which risks are often obscured. A massive amount of input comes from advisors, media, and sometimes gossip. Distortions are inevitable. Sometimes the sheer volume and variety of information cause misinterpretations, and other times, people delivering information are willfully misleading. Those who try to influence a leader may shape their message with such skill as to steer the leader's attention, encourage them to accept a particular version of the truth, and take the wrong actions. Leaders also have their own tendencies of thinking that are influenced by cognitive biases, beliefs, and experiences that interfere with their ability to see reality. Yet, even with conscious and unconscious, unwitting and willful distortion, leaders must make decisions that affect their teams, the organization, and perhaps even the world. How can you make good leadership decisions when awash with so much good information and so much wrong information? It takes what I call meta-leadership, the ability to step back from all the noise and distortion and see things as they truly are. When you master the art of meta-leadership, you have a huge competitive advantage over those who make decisions based on distortion and whose confidence remains intact even as they stand on shaky ground. All the time, millions, if not billions, of dollars are committed to ill-advised strategic moves by leaders who feel confident without good reason. The art of meta-leadership allows you to be far better than competitors at seeing what is true and what isn't. Your decisions will be more accurate. You will be justifiably confident, and your competitors won't know what hit them. We need to avoid this trap. Information gets distorted in many ways. In meta-leadership, how to see what others don't and make great decisions, I examine a cognitive trap so prevalent, people rarely take note of it. Dichotomous thinking, or thinking in black and white, as though with any choice, there is a clear, definitive, correct approach and an equally clear wrong one. Because the world is more connected than at any time in history, it is more complex. Although we have enormous amounts of data and input, we can't trust that it is all accurate. The first cognitive task is attention. To what do we attend? The second is meaning. What does this thing, person, or idea mean? Where does this input fit, or does it? Humans have a tremendous capacity to sort with little effort or awareness, and this is both a gift and a trap. When we attend to familiar people and situations, the risk of mistakes is lower because we use experience and patterns within those experiences to guide our decisions, and we do so with little effort. However, when something is unfamiliar or perhaps dangerous, It is riskier to rely on quick, black and white thinking, which tends to amplify similarities and discount differences that, although subtle, may be important. I first noticed the trap of dichotomous thinking decades ago when I was a stockbroker. My clients were all smart people, but they were often swayed by the most irrelevant factors: what their friends advised, where they were employed, and myths about the value of stock splits or reliable dividend payments, and the like. Their emotions were far more influential in their decision-making than they would admit. The most stubborn clients were physicians, accountants, and professors, all of whom trusted their superior knowledge and intellect regardless of their expertise in securities. They were shocked when they suffered losses, but not astonished enough to examine their thinking. I was haunted by how many intelligent, highly skilled, critically thinking people made risky decisions about their money but didn't realize it, no matter my efforts. In particular, I was surprised by people who were stuck in very concrete thinking, such as stocks are bad, people should only buy U.S. Treasury bonds, or I will only consider no-load mutual funds, the others are a ripoff. These are oversimplified ways of thinking, but they have appeal, because when people have strong beliefs, decisions can be made faster and with less effort. Unable to let go of my quandary and finding my colleagues had no explanations to offer for my clients' seemingly incongruent behavior, I dug around in books, first in decision science and then in psychology. I saw that both had something to offer, but decision scientists were mainly hanging on to the idea that people are rational actors, and psychologists were too suspicious of investing to take a genuine interest. Then the stock market crashed. On Monday, October 19th, 1987, the Dow Jones suffered the most significant percentage loss of all time, 22.6%. At the time of writing, the same percentage drop would equate to nearly 8,000 points, a panic-inducing loss for sure. In the chaos that ensued, I observed how different people responded. Some were sanguine and looked to the larger context in history. These people did nothing with their investments, and I was among them. However, some people panicked and made terrible, life-altering decisions, like selling all their investments at the worst possible time. Still others blamed their advisors, brokers, and even spouses for losses that, unless investments were sold, were paper losses only. Seeing how people responded ignited my desire to understand the world's best thinkers and leaders and what made them different, especially in a crisis. In the aftermath of the crash, it became clear that I was in the wrong job. So I quit and went back to school. I found a place where asking questions was not a sign of weakness. If a professor didn't know an answer but thought my question was interesting, they suggested I investigate. Finally, I was on the right path. Over the next 25 years, I advised more than 40 boards and more than 100 leaders at the top of companies in over 25 industries in more than 30 countries on 5 continents. I have seen leaders try various tactics to improve leadership, teamwork, and results, with various degrees of success and sometimes complete failure. One leader who consulted me after a failed attempt to make a major change said, "We spent $1 million and got a pep rally." That's what happens when you take shortcuts, jump on bandwagons, and use rigid methods. The best leaders I know, and some I have studied at a distance, adopt the strategy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.